Hey, welcome back to Mobility Wad. This is our first ever all dedicated skiing edition. We are up in Tahoe at Start House. Our good friends up here said, hey, you know what? You need to have skis in the background to make this legit. So they have graciously, this is our local ski shop, and they've graciously let us film up here. What we want to do today is talk about a few things about getting ready for ski season. First, there is some idea that you should be in shape for ski season. And I, anytime I say getting in shape for ski season, I always laugh a little bit because why are you already out of shape? And why aren't you already squatting, doing things you need to do? So we're going to put that on the side because I'm sure that you're already fit enough to ski. So let's talk about some mechanics. Now, I grew up skiing. I grew up in Germany racing. I chased FIS as a kid, skiing the JOs. The problem with skiing, and I have a lot of skiing background and my family skis, et cetera, et cetera. The problem with skiing is that we're automatically sort of put into some very, very real mechanical compromises. And what we see is that people are not ready for some of the ranges of motion and requirement for skiing. And then because of the equipment, actually, it's not very natural, and we end up sort of with some default mechanics that are a little bit suspect. So let me just kind of elaborate. First and foremost is that the way my ankles work is that when I block myself into ski boots and dorsiflex, what's going to normally happen as I drive into the tongue is that my arch is going to collapse. It's almost impossible to try to maintain that arch and press into the ski boot without clinching down. And then as soon as I end up skiing, I'm going to be creating too much stiffness in the foot. So what ends up happening then is that normally, good knee function is that the knee actually tracks a little bit outside the toe, and I'm looking at maintaining what we call that neutral foot. So if I put my foot into a neutral position and then let the knee track, it tracks a little bit towards the outside of the little toe, right? So but that's a kind of a varus skiing position. That means I'm going to be skiing down, and that's never going to happen. The ski boot locks me into a path. So what ends up happening is then, typically, and back me up, we see a lot of insoles and footbeds inside ski boots. And so what happens is that we've made a compromise and said, hey, let's block that foot so that the arch doesn't collapse and we don't see a wholesale drop of the navicular bone and a twist of the foot as soon as I pressure. And this is a big problem in the ski boot. So, and there are, my understanding is there are a couple theories about that. You let the foot happen, do that naturally, or let's support the bottom of the foot. So most of us end up putting some kind of arch support in here, the same arch support that we think is probably requisite and important in biking, in a bike shoe. But as soon as I now have a solid footbed, as I drop forward, I will not send that energy through that navicular bone and dropping it in. So what ends up happening then is that I end up kind of with a little bit more of a blocked foot, requiring really excellent ankle range of motion. So this is compromise number one, which means that if my ankles are stiff to begin with, I'm asking a lot more out of sort of the bottom part of the ankle joint, and I'm also asking a lot more out of the top where that fibular head is coming up in the top of the on top of the knee. So we're going to make sure that we're addressing that when we think about sort of how do I get my feet ready, how am I taking care of my shins, why are my feet cramping so bad in the bottom of the boot. Okay, that's number one. Number two is that as soon as I put myself into this aggressive lean, and Jared, what is the typical cant forward on a boot? How many degrees is that? No idea. Let's just call it boot flex, whatever the normal boot flex is. But if what'll end up happening is if you squeeze your butt and put yourself into a neutral spine, we know that this is your best approximation of relationship between your pelvis and your lumbar spine. The problem is, if I'm going to just bend my knees, I'm going to have to work hard on keeping that torso upright to be able to bend. And what we end up seeing, of course, is that's not the case. What we end up doing then is creating a little bit of an anterior pelvic tilt. So if you observe most people in the ski line, what they're doing is in order to create this tilt, they're not spending time here. They're actually keeping the torso upright, especially as I fatigue. Knees drive forward, and as that happens, I end up seeing this go with it. And so this leads me into a couple things. One is that my anterior hip gets very short, low back gets pumped out. And if you ever talk to people skiing bumps and feel their low back pump out during that bump run, you know what I'm talking about, that's resulting from basically loading through the spine instead of keeping the torso upright. It's very difficult. And what you'll see always, because I was a racer and I watched the racers in line, is that as soon as you get a chance in the ski line, what you'll see is that immediately everyone defaults to this position. And what the reason we're in this position is it basically unloads this anterior hip, and I can take that load out of my low back. So imagine that most of the athletes I know tend to be short in the anterior hip anyway, tend to be stiff in the quads, the iliopsoas, and the iliacus, and the QL, right? Those four horsemen sort of these anterior structures. And so I have a recipe for kind of getting tighter and tighter. Now, the problem with losing the pelvis is suddenly I have a lot less control of the hip during angulation. So what I'm trying to do is make sure that I can maintain this neutral position. So if I'm upright, then that's why we end up adding so much twist kind of hip to the snow to allow this to happen, or I end up having to cant forward to ski to make this work. But this is a relationship now where I've got to be able to have good hip function because I'm basically performing a good morning as I ski, all right? So as we're thinking through this, what we need to do is think, okay, one, how am I going to get prepped for the ski day? Now, typically, most skiers wake up a little bit stiff, maybe sore, maybe it's the first day of the season, you're not sore yet. What ends up happening is you eat a little breakfast, you drive to the ski slope after spending the night in the car the day before, and literally you roll out of the car, you have a hard time buckling your boots, and subsequently what we end up seeing is that very, very little warm-up happens. People are basically making an easy run, maybe, but what's happened is they haven't taken their joints through full range of motion, we haven't got good perfusion in the tissues to be able to handle some of the very, very high-speed compression loads. So what we want to do is instead of saying, hey, I'm going to go ahead and get up to the base and start swinging my leg and pulling my ski back and trying to do some ridiculous two-second squats or two-second sort of movement prep with skis on. And so what I'm going to propose is a completely different model. And that model is this. I would like you to get up an extra 20 minutes early at most and spend a few minutes getting yourself prepped for the ski day. And let me just give you some ideas. So what we tend to do is we say, hey, let's prioritize joint mechanics first, and we'll get ourselves warmed up. So if you got a hot shower, had a cup of coffee, let's get your joints warmed up in your house, in your kind of long underwear, and then we'll go ski, because it won't take us much to kind of reclaim that position. Once I'm hot and sweaty and starting to ski a little bit, the physiology will kind of upregulate. And then tonight, when we get home, we're gonna do some soft tissue work to manage the loads and the sort of imposed sort of compromises of skiing, and also help me to downregulate and get ready for tomorrow. So we're always thinking about getting ready for tomorrow, especially those of us who are skiing on weeks or weekends, or we're doing multiple days in a row, or we're taking on ski trips. So here's number one. What we're going to think about is, first thing in the morning, I want you hot and sweaty before you can do this, or before we start mobilizing. The easiest thing to do to get ready for skiing is to get a jump rope. You can throw this in your bag. And we get a couple things out of this. One is that I just practice waking up the nervous system, and I can get a hot sweat in almost any room without having to sort of go to the treadmill or get on the exercise bike and quickly. So in this position, what I'm exaggerating is a couple things. One is that my butt is squeezed, so I can practice keeping my butt on as I extend my hip, which is a motor cue for when I'm skiing. I want to be able to activate the glute without turning the glute off and just letting this be quad dominant, which is a kind of very common ski-related problem, instead of being in this position where my butt is working effectively to absorb force. What I really like out of this is that, remember, your feet are going to be encased in plastic all day. And what I want to do is get your feet ready sort of for the demands and rigors of being entombed. And an easy way to do that is not only just that single leg or double leg jumping with toes together, but what I'm also going to suggest is that we do some single leg jumping. So put that other foot out and try to get 100 total skips between left and right, working up to 100 skips left, 100 skips right. So landing and loading, getting my calf ready, doing 10 on this side. And even if I don't have a jump rope, just working on keeping my butt tight, being straight up and down will make a difference. Once you're set, here's our basic hip sequence opener. What I'm going to start with is our basic squat open sequence. Now, one of the problems that we see is that athletes, when they're skiing, and I end up in kind of a full compression position, if I'm missing hip flexion, what ends up happening is that as the knee comes to the chest, my pelvis tends to dump backwards. And then that puts me into a flexed lumbar position. And if you saw the tweet we did with Bodie Miller's lumbar spine, you saw some of the disc tissue they had to take out of his spinal canal. What's happening there is he's been compressed and loaded so many times that he's basically ejected some of the contents of his disc. So we want to restore that knee to chest. We'll talk about that in a second. For starters, I'm just gonna put myself into a deep squat, hand on the foot, and then we're gonna do our basic opener. And I'm gonna spend 2 or 3 minutes opening this. Back foot is straight. I'm getting a little opening of the hip capsule here. As I do this, I'm going to start bringing my body over. This brings foot to midline. I'm gonna push on the knee. I can shift my weight over, and then I'm gonna scour back and forth into the hip capsule here, trying to get that tight, stiff hip to open. So this is position one in this shape. Position two in this shape is I turn and look at the knee, and I'm gonna push the knee away and catch the top of the hip here, this TFL, glute med, glute min, and push onto that. And then my final thing is I'm gonna look away from the knee and push away and try to get this hip open, because what I'm looking for is a lot of independent hip motion. We'll come into the internal rotation in a second. So once I've done that, I'll switch sides. Again, I want to just put 2 or 3 minutes into this shape, playing around with these different positions. I want to reclaim my hip function. I'm opening up the hamstring even if I floss back. I've got the anterior hip here, opening up the hip. Now once I've done both sides, I'm going to switch back. Let the foot drop out to the side here, keeping the knee off the ground, belly button to knee, and I'm gonna do the same sequence again. I'm gonna scour around, hand on the foot or hand on knee, look away, and it opens up a little bit more of some of those lateral tissues, changes a little bit. So that's number one. Number two then is I'm gonna spend some time in this deep position. So I'm trying to close my foot down, make sure that my ankle's working, open up the heel cord, keeping the knee out. And you can test this idea of neutral foot yourself. Let your knee drop in and see what happens. You'll collapse your arch. So I want to drive the knee out, maintain that foot position, starting to open the adductor here. And I'm just going to work, keeping the butt as low as I can. I'm going to shift my weight to the other side. Once again, spending time in full hip flexion here, knee out, opening up the kind of this groin bit, which is a huge deal when I'm making my little A-frame turns. Shin goes vertical. Grinding as low as I can back across the capsule, back and down, and I'm gonna shift back and forth 10 or 20 times. Camp out here for a second, shift low, really, really wide stance, oh, settle back and down, open up that hip a little bit, when I'm gonna start to feel a little bit more open. Okay, now, hips are starting to open a little bit. I'm just gonna spend another 2 minutes in this position. What I'm trying to do is I'm going to approximate the hip to the back of the socket. We call this a hip capsule stretch. Leg comes across. Now what I'm doing is I'm not dropping into pigeon pose. I'm trying to get my hip rotators a little bit warmed up, and reset that hip into a good position. So knee drives to the back of the socket, vector force going through the knee. I kick the leg across the body, and then I'm just going to push into some little corners. What I'm thinking about is where's the vector where I'm restricted? So I can scour back and forth. All the while, I'm keeping my line of force going through the femur so it feels like my hip's gonna pop out. Then, I'm gonna kick the leg into some internal rotation. External rotation, the femur's moving externally. Internal rotation, block the foot. And then I'm gonna twist and try to open up and grind that hip into the hip capsule. Again, keeping the hip going back, and I'm just gonna twist around, keep driving that knee to the back, and then keep closing that hip down a little bit, and just think about oscillating in. 2 or 3 minutes of that, okay? Now, I'm starting to get hips and ankles warmed up. And there's one more thing. We're gonna spend some time really exaggerating. Now, typically we tend to stay the soft tissue stretching like things for afterwards, but you need to do this if you're a skier, and that is the couch. So we're going to come back, foot up against the corner of the wall, bring the leg up,
and I'm gonna keep the hand down, I'm gonna keep my butt squeezed, and I'm gonna press the hip down 20 to 30 times, or as many times as I can in about a minute. And then I'm gonna open up the chest, belly tight, and I'm gonna press forward. So I'm really exaggerating the loads on the quads. I skied today and we just trained, so I'm a little bit stiff. And remember, it's sort of a moving target. So one of the things that I'm trying to do is undo the damage of the day and the stiffness of the day and get myself ready for tomorrow. Okay, so that would be a basic sort of quick prep hip thing. All right, and getting myself ready. Now when I go ski, you're gonna be shocked at how much better the turns feel right off the bat. Now, when we're coming back home, what we wanna do is think about a couple things. One, as soon as you get the ski boots off, I want you to grab a pair of compression socks. These things are cheap. These are by CEP, well worth the time.
whatever brand you like, 2x U, it doesn't matter, Skins, whoever's making a good sock. But the idea here is that this is a very, very inexpensive intervention. What ends up happening is that because you're constantly on your feet but not contracting actively a lot of your calf and foot musculature, we tend to see that the foot becomes very congested during the course of a ski day. What we want to do is reclaim and decongest that feet. Now, most of us get off, we don't think about doing some exercise or some aerobic conditioning or something afterwards, or some training. Usually done, we start drinking right away. I'm just saying, it's possible. J-Star, do you agree with that?
It happens.
So what I want you to do is be thinking, okay, now I'm trying to down-regulate. I've got probably something cold or adult beverage in my hand, or not, a protein recovery shake on you, but I want you to throw a pair of compression socks on. This will change how sore your legs are the next day going to the boot. We hear a lot of people, day two, day three, day four, the first part of the season, their shins are really, really brutalized, and some of that brutalization is that the fact that those tissues swelled from compression and we didn't evacuate that swelling. So some sort of passive compression can make a big difference. Now, when we look at the bottom of the foot here, we use their little model, you can see that behind the inside of the shin here, I have a lot of musculature that comes down and then supports the arch. And this is the area where people are tending to feel very, very crampy in the bottom of their feet. And that's because we've, again, sort of taken away the normal motion, and this musculature is freaking out trying to figure out how to stabilize in this little tiny space. Most of us are, at the beginning of the season, our feet are wide, and we call it summer feet, even though your feet should look like that all year round, and it takes our bones a while to kind of compress into these really, really torturous and unnatural positions. So the idea is, let's not let your feet adapt to the boot, let's reclaim your feet. And so starting from the ground up, I'm going to use some kind of ball. This is our Super Novito. It's our 80 millimeter ball. It creates a lot of grip, but it doesn't matter whatever ball you're using, a lacrosse ball, a baseball, some kind of cricket ball. But first thing we're going to reclaim your feet. So get your feet out of the boot, and I'm just going to sandwich side to side. Now, what I'm thinking is, I'm going to put a clock on this. Maybe 10 minutes of getting ready in the morning, and then 10 to 15 minutes of soft tissue work at the evening. Get whatever you can get done, and don't worry about the rest. So we're trying to reclaim that arch. I'm trying to smash above my feet. I'm going to smash side to side from right above the heel, and I'm going to work all the way across. You're going to be so shocked at how stiff those feet are after a day of being on your feet. Okay, number two, I'm going to take this bad boy, and I'm going to go ahead and smash it into my anterior shin. So I'm going to spend a few minutes of the day basically clearing the shin, which was working so hard in the front of the boot. I'm just going to touch that. Where we see our athletes really, really needing this, though, for the soft tissue work with the ball, is we want to clear the side of the hip. So I'm going to go right into that hip flexor, smashing that out right in the area, not hip flexor, but the sort of flexor wad. If you lean up and kneel, you'll get this big grippy tissue here. I basically want to peel that off the bone and then also clear up the tissue and musculature right above the hip. So what it looks like is I just lay down, and now the rules of thumb for soft tissue mobilization, you already know, it shouldn't be painful and it shouldn't be stiff. So if I find something that's painful or I can't breathe, I'm resisting, that's a problem. So I need to be able to take off a little pressure, make sure I can breathe in and breathe out, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna contract and relax, and contract and relax until I can take my full weight on it. So I'm gonna do that to both hips. Clearly, this is decent on the hamstrings and all the other tissues, but now we're gonna get to sort of the main component, and that is I wanna clean up the calf. So I'm going to do some side-to-side smashing on a wine bottle, on a beer can. It doesn't matter. You should have some kind of roller in your bag. And I'm just going to work my way up. If I get an ugly spot, I can clean it up. But I'm going to keep working that side-to-side. So much of the knee pain we see around skiing is not because of the sort of the knee. It's because of the tight musculature and tissues behind the knee here in the calf. And I can work that all the way up. And then above the knee. And so the last piece, of course, is that I'm just going to flip on my stomach right above the knee here, and then just smash that and floss that side to side. So that will be the kind of basis of my soft tissue work for the lower leg. Now, when I'm thinking sort of the remainder of the tissues above the joint, I will regularly take the ball and get into the areas of my iliacus. So right inside the hip bone here is sort of one of your prime hip flexors. And what I can do is take any ball that I've got and just put it right inside my pelvis and then just internally and externally rotate this. A kid's ball will work, a soccer ball, anything to sort of unglue the very, very powerful hip flexors that have gotten short from being in this position. Now, there's a bonus here. And if you've got the setup for it, this is one of Mark Bell's hip circles. This is, I want to throw this last because I don't want to confuse you with the fact that we don't need very much equipment to sort of get prepped in a hotel room. But if you've got the setup, this is a hip circle. I grab a band, and this could all be done with TheraBand, right? Or some bands that you get at the store. Goes behind the neck, and my absolute favorite prep for this is I squeeze the butt, drive the knees out, maintaining this sort of neutral shape, which is where we're doing a lot of our skiing these days, and then I'm gonna basically take my hip through a full range of motion, back flat, have to shove the knees out, and then I'm gonna come back and through. And what I'm doing here is I'm practicing setting the hip into a good butt squeeze position that sets the relationship between pelvis and lumbar. I practice screwing my feet into the ground, which activates the hip, and I have to keep that knee active the whole time so that we don't see that dreaded fault come in where the knee collapses. So I do about 20 or 30 of these before I jump in the car. The idea here is, once again, to be thinking, boy, skiing is fun, but it's not natural. Make sure I'm drinking enough water, I'm getting some snacks, all that makes good sense. But let's divide your training into, hey, before you go ski, are you ready and prepped? And the answer is resoundingly no. I watch people in the parking lot struggling to get their ski boots on. That tells me about their hip function. So what I want you to do, Juliet's laughing because that was her today. What I want you to do is to spend 10 or 15 minutes getting prepped before you get in the car and before you go ski. Then when you just warm up, you won't have to do any craziness and you'll feel much better. Coming home, throw on some compression socks, develop a 10 to 15 minute soft tissue practice intervention, and you will see a remarkable capacity to continue to ski and to ski well through the week or through the season. Friends at Starthouse, thank you guys very much. This is Mobility Watt. See you tomorrow.